Dr. J.K. Jena, Deputy Director General, Fishery Science and Animal Science, and my valued colleague at the ICAR headquarters, Dr. Saxena, Director of Export Inspection Council of India, and several dignitaries, experts from abroad, Dr. Weimin Miao from the FAO, Dr. Chamberlain, Dr. Robbins, Dr. Jim Weiban, and also our own colleague, Dr. Y.S. Yadav, Dr. Vijayan, the convener of this particular conference, Dr. Alavandi, organizing secretary of BRAQCON, many dignitaries of the dais. In fact, they are so eminent, working for many, many years in fishery sector. My own colleagues, directors from various institutes of ICAR, Dr. Ravi Shankar, Dr. Kuldeep Lal, Dr. Gopal Krishnan, Dr. Bindu Pillai, and also the delegates from various institutions who are present here today, various organizations, not necessarily the Indian Council of Agriculture Research System, also representatives of private sector that is so deeply engaged in this particular promotion of fishery in India. Delegates from abroad, I see many from abroad being present here in this conference. And representatives of government departments who are also present here. Lastly, the representatives of press and media. I welcome on my own behalf and also behalf of the Indian Council of Agriculture Research and Department of Agriculture Research and Education, Government of India. A hearty welcome to each one of you. I congratulate the organizers for having conceived this idea of having or hosting this conference here in Chennai. Thanks to particularly Dr. Vijayan, Director Shiva, for putting in all efforts to have this conference here. The hall is full. Yesterday we were discussing that how many chairs there could be. He was telling it's close to 1,000, because yesterday there are almost 1,000 farmers present here, and with that this conference started. And today probably additional chairs have been arranged to accommodate everyone, and that speaks volumes about the interest, deep interest, that this particular conference has generated, not only in India, but also those who are working in the area abroad. And that also speaks about the importance of the sector globally and very specifically also in India. I am not an expert in fishery sector. I never worked in this area. though I was associated in some form in one of the programs, but I have been informed through discussion with my colleagues what is really happening. India's fishery sector is a vibrant sector. Dr. J.K. Jena has already given the overview of what is happening and the issues and concerns which require to be addressed. Also, Dr. Saxena has given a perspective in relation to export and also the concerns and issues thereof. I need not actually repeat those, but few issues I will also highlight. Certainly, we have grown in this sector and done pretty well. In 1950-51, our production was about 0.7 million ton. So less than 1 million ton production. And we have gone beyond 11 million tons. And that is more than 14 times growth in fishery sector in India. The global production scenario, if you analyze, certainly China is much ahead of everyone else, and we are a distant follower with regard to the volume of production if we compare. But the growth that we have attained is remarkable, primarily because fish is considered in this country as a very important component of our diet system. Particularly, earlier confined to mostly to coastal belts, but now it has spread to many different areas. And as an important component of nutrition, and given the malnutrition so pervasive in this part of the world, despite consumption of fish, so the sector assumes greater importance. The sustainable development goals, if we talk about, it has challenges in terms of the nutrition targets that we have to achieve. Certainly, the fishery sector has to play a bigger role than what has played in the past. Not only that, for our internal consumption and meeting the nutritional targets, we need to promote fishery sector, but also it's important to earn foreign exchange by way of exports to meet the requirements elsewhere and to capture the markets in the global arena. And probably that sector is very, very important and also remain quite vibrant. As Dr. Saxena was telling, that our export has reached $7 billion with regard to various fishes. And I am told 80 to 90% of this comes from the brackish water species, the Pineus venami. And that credit goes to the sector. And very important, that's the reason why I said that the conference on brackish water aquaculture assumes relevance and has great significance in the context of fishery economy that we talk about, fishery sector economy that we talk about. When we say agricultural economy, and certainly the domestic demand, supply, and the gaps thereof, and the international market forces that compel us to actually redesign our strategy to be there to exploit and also take advantage of both indigenous, the domestic, and the international markets compel us to discuss, to deliberate, to strategize, and also define course of action so that we remain relevant, remain productive, and also make it remunerative to the farmers and also highly profitable to the sector, particularly the private sector, who are also deeply engaged in this particular area. The kind of increase that we have seen in export, I am told, is 20% as compared to previous year. Now that is remarkable. How do we maintain that over a period of time? It's a challenge, and that requires quite a bit of efforts. It's not just relevant for India alone. The brackish water aquaculture is relevant globally. The species that we use today has come from elsewhere. Certainly, Pineus monodon, as Dr. Jena said, we were growing, the crops were harvested, and the consumption pattern was also preferring that particular one and still continue to prefer that. But certainly, the kind of devastation that we faced in the form of disease, and the large-scale cultivation was discontinued. And today, we have the American white shrimp, the Pineus venami, that occupies the large area, not only in the coastal belt, but also the inland brackish water aquaculture. Very successful one in Haryana and Punjab. Thanks to my colleagues for the research they have done, but also in just not promoting the species that we got from outside and keep getting the brood stocks regularly, but also maintaining in terms of quarantine, the control which is so essential to maintain the health and promote the sector. The very fact that we did not have major disaster in the form of disease, that speaks volumes about the kind of health management system that we have put in place in the country that has enabled the sector to grow. So I congratulate everyone who has been involved, engaged in this particular sector, including those in the private, and also my own colleagues in the research institutions here at SIBA, and also those at CIFE. I do not know how many from CIFE are present here. We have received congratulatory messages from the Chief Minister, the previous Chief Minister of Punjab, for successful implementation of venami culture there. And not only the maintenance, the health management, but also the feed system management. Dr. Jena did emphasize on this. So we have done quite a bit of work, and the Venami Plus of this particular institute, SIBA, has captured the imagination of everyone engaged in this sector, and in fact is being promoted, and that's what the credit that we take in different fora and how we have really managed this. And particularly the diagnostics that the institute developed some years ago to detect the WSSV wild spot syndrome virus. And that is something which is being also utilized for the benefit of the sector. So the science-led responsible fishing, particularly with regard to American white shrimp, the Venami, in this country, is a success story, and that needs to be actually continued with more vigor and also with greater input of innovations. Innovations are required, not only with regard to the shrimp, but also in totality in the brackish water aquaculture. There are various issues to be addressed. The brackish water aquaculture, globally and also very specifically in this country, has remained confined to a limited number of species at commercial scale. I am told my colleagues at the institute has developed induced breeding technology for a few others, the sea bass, the milkfish, and this is picking up. We have not been able to commercialize as much as it is with regard to the white shrimp. The systems are in place, but I believe we need to work with regard to promotion of these, engaging the private sector, and immensely supported by the government policies. The sea bass and also milkfish. Milkfish, I am told, this is the vegetarian one. And obviously in this case, expectedly the feed cost would be lesser than the sea bass. But the growth rate, particularly with regard to sea bass, as I am told, is slow. Takes several months while you get a full-grown crop. In 90 to 120 days with regard to shrimp, appropriate size of about 10 to 12 grams, you don't get that advantage with sea bass. What is the science that is required to do research in this, enhance the growth rate, and also have a crop in shorter period of time so that the benefit enhances for the growers, for the farmers? I think we need to, as it is said, the American white shrimp has been bred, and the concerned person is here to tell you more about how it is being done. I believe we have some degree of success with the indicus at this institute. We need to actually put greater emphasis and efforts to come to the level at which the American white shrimp has been popularized, and how much of research is required. I am told the selective breeding has been quite successful in this particular case. Why we cannot do that kind of selective breeding with regard to indicus, also even monodon, or even the other species. So the breeding systems, and when I look at and have a comparison with the plants, as a plant geneticist, I believe there's quite a bit of parallel existing between the two systems. Unlike the animal systems, where the progeny size is always limited. And here, the progeny size could be even bigger than the plants. And selection system could be quite rigorous, not only with regard to growth, but also with regard to other traits. For instance, disease resistance. Can we have that kind of rigorous mating and breeding systems? Interspecific mating, interspecies mating, using chinensis, for instance, the smaller size, Dr. Jena tells me, the China species, the chinensis, openness is very small, not very small, relatively small. And in contrast, the monodon is relatively large. And various traits are there. And how much trait discovery you have done in different species. And in different populations of indicus, for instance. That should be opportunities for us to deliberate how we can actually take advantage of the diversity. The species diversity, at the population level diversity existing, and study that for trait discovery, and go for diverse sets to be utilized, the broods to be utilized, brooders to be utilized in mating, to get a larger population for effective selection to operate with appropriate selection intensity, and selecting the appropriate ones with appropriate growth rate, and all that, I believe that is possible. And that kind of effort, my colleagues in plant breeding, when they grow a small F2 population of 200, 300, or 400 plants, certainly they don't get that kind of segregant. And often we call transgressive segregants. But if you have a population of 5,000 or 50,000, certainly the chance of getting those transgressive segregants are much bigger and better and higher. And I believe the American white shrimp has been bred through very systematic process of breeding. And we should be able to replicate and create our own niche. And also in the process create a market for ourselves at the global level. Friends, certainly the genomic tools are emerging quite fast. And we should be able to take advantage of those schemes. We are planning for genomic selection in animals. And can we, given the kind of genome sequencing that has happened in case of fish species, quite a bit of them, and we are doing in case of catfish, in case of hilsa, and certainly globally, there are many examples and then sequences are available in public domain. And can we not take advantage of that to design selection schemes like genomic selection to operate and in a predictive fashion we select the best ones in the progeny. The marker-assisted breeding has not happened to that extent as much it has happened in case of plants or as it is happening in case of animals. And I believe there is great scope for this in case of fishery sector. Particularly when we have induced breeding happening in species as described for the brackish water system. And there is a great scope for that. So friends, when I say genomic selection, certainly in addition to this, we have the newer tool of genome editing. As you all know, through transgenic system, we have also GM fish, which is already commercially available, the particularly the salmon. the GM salmon, the muscularly, you know, so enriched salmon through GM system, GM modification, genetic modification. And the other fishery sector is untouched almost, particularly in this country. And that should be great scope, and particularly genome editing. Genome editing for WSSV control management, as we have done particularly globally. American swine fever in case of pig is a beautiful example that how genome editing can be utilized very effectively. In the fishery sector, there could be plenty of opportunities to deliberate, to discuss, and define programs based on genome editing to address some of these challenges which we have not been able to actually address otherwise. Management has been very successful, but genetic means would be far more promising and cheaper option to adopt and employ and deploy than the management options. Friends, it's not just genetics and breeding and genomics which is important. There are quite a bit of other areas which have assumed so much importance in recent years. When you have intensive farming systems operating in this country, we have high production systems operating, and we have gone beyond 5 tons per hectare. I am told 2 tons is quite sustainable system, and we have gone up to 4 to 5 tons, and at times we are going beyond 10 tons and going up to 20 tons per hectare in intensive production system. Unless and until we go for sustainable aquaculture, particularly taking care of the ecology and ecosystem, will not be able to remain successful on a long-term perspective. How do we actually address that? The kind of feeds which are used and the kind of eutrophication that take place, the kind of antibiotics which are being utilized. We are discussing antimicrobial resistance, and this is a serious concern globally. We have formulated a program, and we are also working with the Indian Council of Medical Research that how do we address this in animals and also in fish. And you have seen reports in press that how the antibiotic use in certain sectors is quite rampant. Misuse is the one which is a matter of serious concern. And when we think of export and try to capture the global market, certainly, this assumes greater significance and relevance. How do we actually impose this? Rigorous monitoring and systems to be in place to monitor, check, and prevent misuse of various chemicals, including antibiotics. My colleagues in CIFT, they have developed a system to identify and see what kind of chemicals are being utilized, for instance, formaldehyde, to preserve fish during storage and also long distance transport, and other chemicals as well. The kind of diagnostics that have been developed by different institutions in the country and elsewhere, they have to be put in place, not only to ensure that we have a sustainable fishery system in this country. Also, at the same time, we have to use the diagnostic systems for rigorous surveillance, particularly when we see the rivers have gone beyond borders, particularly, say, Bangladesh and India, Nepal and India, India and Pakistan, so on and so forth. When I see those, certainly, there is a great need of rigorous surveillance using proper diagnostics so that we prevent the serious damage to the fishery sector by way of transboundary diseases, which can come and invade the system by way of invasive species, by way of diseases which are not existing in India, but elsewhere. And I believe what Dr. Saxena was emphasizing, that is so important for the sector to actually take care of. And that requires great deal of discussion, deliberation, and systematic approach so that we join hands all in South Asia or Southeast Asia together, join hands and work to solve the problems of transboundary issues that we see, and that we see that a great threat that might afflict us not in distant future, but near future. Certainly, this sector requires quite a bit of analysis with regard to nutrition. We say the fish is important for nutrition, and it needs to be promoted for nutrition. But how much actually we have analyzed the nutritional profile, the biomolecular profile of the feces, particularly today's context, the brackish water aquaculture fish species, and how much we understand the nutraceutical values of the compound that are there in the fish species in general, and also the brackish water species in particular. The compounds, particularly the peptides, the small peptides which are existing, maybe secondary metabolites which are of relevance from health perspective, from nutrition perspective, we need to actually have a thorough discussion and have programs defined nationally and globally to go for discovery of new molecules in fish species, and particularly in today's context, the brackish water aquaculture species. And I believe there will be great scope to build into entrepreneurship by way of a discovery of new molecules. And certainly, entrepreneurship is important in this sector. The engagement of private has been so crucial for success of this particular sector. How do we engage private and continue engaging unless this is beneficial to them, profitable to them, they would not venture into this system. How do we attract the young talents and engage them more and more in brackish water aquaculture development and the feed system development, the breeding system development, and the health system management all together, and our private sector can remain vibrant? And how do we actually deliberate and engage more and more with the private sector so that they are more interested and they contribute to the system and they contribute to the research? How much of private investment in research has happened here in India? Negligible. They have to be engaged at the research stage so that the technology which is developed by the public institutions immediately find place in the private sector and they utilize this large scale for benefit of the sector. Not only the consumers, but also the growers, the small farmers. As you all know, the fish farmers in this country, just like crop farmers or horticulture farmers, they're small and marginal. And often, they are the ones who go to deep sea to do fishing. And their resources are limiting. The CIFT developing quite a bit of technologies. Director Ravi Shankar is there. And so also other institutions. My institution, CMFRI, is developing, identifying several new species and discovering and also bringing them back to induced breeding system to provide them to the private sector so that new entrepreneurs, they come in and diversify the sector. The sector diversification is very, very important for its success. This country has quite a bit of a diversified culinary, requirements. and with regard to fishes, and can we actually meet that by way of a diversification? But while doing so, how do we address the social issues that confront us with regard to small and marginal farmers, the fish farmers, and particularly the kind of processing they do at their own place? And we require to discuss and deliberate and then address those issues, for instance, drying, for instance, preservation, the small scale ones. We have plenty of technologies, but it has to reach them to benefit them and handhold them by way of a capacity building. The institutions are engaged, the private can also be engaged so that they skill the youngsters and also do capacity building of the small and marginal ones, so that the fishery sector of small and marginal farmers remain effective, remain remunerative, so that we meet the dreams, the challenge of doubling farmers' income, the kind of challenge Honorable Prime Minister has placed before us. That's the call to all of us who are working in the sector of agriculture and allied sector, that we have to double the income of the farmers by 2022. The time is limiting, and in this limited time, can we employ fishery sector? The previous Director General of the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, Dr. Ayappan, used to emphasize the fishery goes with money, the Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth, and that is associated with the fishery sector. And can we actually make this happen in true sense, that the small and marginal farmers benefit, they become wealthy, and their income doubles by 2022. How effectively we integrate fishery sector with other sectors so that we have real sense integrated farmings are promoted, and so that we have real development taking place, and so that we have doubling of the farmers taking place in another 3 to 4 years' time. My dear friends, this is the time to discuss, deliberate, join hands, and then move faster with a far greater velocity and far greater efficiency than ever before. And this particular conference provides that kind of platform to deliberate and then get clarity from the expertise from elsewhere, from the experts who have, the delegates who have come from outside, to learn from them and then partner with them and implement here in the country, for not only for the advantage of the consumers in India, but for the global consumers. And I would wish this conference a great success. I believe the deliberations will bring out implementable recommendations for us to deliberate further and implement. It will bring out policy dimensions which are so important for this sector to flourish in future. I congratulate the organizers, particularly Dr. Jena, and also the director of this institute, Shiva, Dr. Bijayan, for making this conference happen and to make it a grand success. I believe that with the engagement of all of you, it will be a successful endeavor, and it will certainly bring us many implementable recommendations. Thank you very much for coming here, particularly my colleagues from outside who have come here and participating to help us out, to provide us new directions so that we move faster. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.